Okay, so that takes us through working some basic problems relating to the ionization of strong acids and strong bases in aqueous solutions. In biological solutions, however, we rarely deal with strong acids and strong bases, at least by themselves, because our cells are full of weak acids, and these weak acids do not completely ionize when we put them into solution. Therefore, it's important that we understand ways to determine hydrogen ion concentrations in solutions like that. So the type of reaction I'm talking about here is that of a weak acid. And weak acids we might tend to think about in the same way we do strong acids. That is, that a weak acid, shown here as the HA, dissociates into a proton, shown here, and what I call a salt, that is the thing that remains, where A is any particular salt of a weak acid. The difference for the weak acid, however, is that weak acids do not completely dissociate. So if I take 1 mole of a weak acid, I will not get 1 mole of protons and 1 mole of salt. It will not completely dissociate. In fact, only a very tiny fraction of that weak acid that I started with will, in fact, dissociate. Now, there's a couple terms here I want you to understand, and it's important because I'll be consistent in the way that I use these terms. I do not use the word base or conjugate base or any of that stuff because I find that students get very confused by what's a weak base, what does that mean, et cetera, et cetera. So rather, I use two terms that I want you to understand. First, the acid is a weak acid. So when I use the HA, that is a weak acid. A good example of a weak acid is acetic acid, HAC, for example. A salt is what you get after you take a proton off of a weak acid. So, as you can see here, the A minus is lacking the proton that came off during the dissociation. So the difference between a weak acid, which I will commonly refer to as an acid, is that a weak acid has one more proton than a salt. And if you keep those two terms in mind, you will always be able to understand the problems that I'm talking about here. Now, to deal with concentrations of protons in solutions of weak acids, we have a different equation that we use. It's known as the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, and the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation is as you can see. That is that the pH is equal to a quantity known as the pKa plus the log of the concentration of the salt divided by the concentration of the acid. Now, what's the pKa? The pKa is a measure of the amount of dissociation that happens of the weak acid. What does that mean? Well, the pH is, you can think of a little bit like the pKa. It's actually the negative log of the acid dissociation constant, which we don't really need to worry too much about here. Suffice it to say that the lower the pKa value is for a weak acid, the stronger that weak acid is. So if I have a weak acid that has a pKa of 2.2, it's a stronger weak acid, meaning it will dissociate more than another weak acid that has a pKa value of 5, okay? Now, the pKa is a constant for any given weak acid, and that's a very important concept to understand. pKa is a constant. It does not change. The pH will change depending upon how much salt and acid is present in a solution, and as you'll see, we can manipulate the amount of salt and acid in a solution by adding a strong acid or a strong base to it, and we'll talk a little bit about that. Okay, now let's take a look at what happens to illustrate graphically what happens with a weak acid when we have it in solution. So as I said, we can alter the concentration of salt and acid in a weak acid by adding either a strong acid or a strong base. And the type of problem that you see right here is relating to the starting of a solution of a weak acid at a very low pH, and then adding increasing amounts as we go through the graph of more and more hydroxide ions that we're adding to the solution. Well, this particular weak acid has a pKa value of 6.37. So this weak acid has a titration curve that looks like this. Now, in freshman chemistry, I'm sure in your laboratories you did titration curves, and titration curves measure pH as a function of the amount of hydroxide that you're adding in the solution. If we look at this pH curve, we see something interesting. First of all, it rises very rapidly as we add tiny amounts of hydroxide at first. And then we see that this titration curve levels off, as we see right here, right around the region where the pKa value is. That's the 6.37. And after that 6.37, it starts rising, and then it gets to a place where it rises very, very rapidly. Now, what we are observing in this portion of the graph, which is about right here, this portion of the graph is showing us what we call the buffering region. And this is why weak acids in aqueous solutions in cells, for example, are very, very important, because weak acids act as what we call buffers, and buffers resist change in pH, meaning that we can add protons, we can add hydroxide ions, and as long as we stay in a certain range, the pH will not change very much compared to if we had no buffer. If we just had water, we would see pH change very drastically, even for the addition of a small amount of protons or hydroxide ions. So this buffering is very important, because cells are very limited in the range of pH values that they can live in. Okay? And this is because the proteins that are in our cells are very, very sensitive to proton concentrations, which of course is pH. So buffers help cells to maintain pH in a narrow range that's acceptable for the cell to be alive. Well, that said, let's think about and let's work through some problems that help to illustrate the idea of buffers and help us to better understand pH values relevant to those.